Okay, thank you for everybody for joining. We have a seminar by Silvia Bonfanti, who will tell us about universal low-frequency vibrational mode in silica glasses. And this is a paper that was just published in Physical Review Letters. And I leave the floor to Silvia, who will tell us about it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Stefano. Hello, everybody. So today I would like to talk about universal low frequency vibrational modes in silica glasses. And first of all, I will spend time for a brief introduction on what are glasses and amorphous materials and why their vibrational properties are very interesting. Actually, as we know, glasses are everywhere around us in our daily life, from window panels up to glasses that we use to drink, for example. And these are made of silica glasses. Other examples of glasses made by silica are, for example, we can see here optical fibers, which are the infrastructure for the internet communication. But there are not just silica glasses. There are many kinds of glasses. For example, here I've selected PET bottles. PET bottles are basically made of polymers, which are in entangled configuration. So these are called polymer glasses. Also, metals can form glasses if they are well prepared. And actually, this kind of metallic glasses are considered as next generation materials because they are more tough with respect to the standard crystalline metals. And as a last example, I've reported here ink. Ink is made of a bunch of colloids when it dries, and therefore this amorphous configuration can be regarded as an example of colloid glasses. So glasses are a class of very familiar materials, but from the scientific perspective, they remains still not completely understood. And I pick up this article from the New York Times of about 20 years ago with a fancy title, "The Nature of Glass Remains Anything But Clear." And this, inside this article, there is Philip Anderson, a famous Nobel Prize, that stated that the deepest and most interesting unsolved problem in solid state theory is probably the theory of glasses and the glass transition. So this is a very important, but at the same time, very difficult problem. Also David Weitz, which is a biophysicist at Harvard, joked that there are more theories of the glass transition than theorists who propose them. So this is to introduce you the topic. But now let's focus on the characteristic feature of glasses, which are what are the properties of glasses. So here I've selected some representative one, the thermodynamics properties, such as the anomalous specific heat behavior, the dynamical properties, so how glasses form, mechanical properties, so when and how and where glasses break, and finally, the topic of this talk, the vibrational properties. And we know that vibrational properties in glasses, we will see, that these vibrational properties are very important to understand also the other key features of glasses, so thermodynamic, dynamical, and mechanical properties. So let's look briefly at the thermodynamic properties of glasses. So glass is a kind of solid, and regarding solids, we know for crystalline materials that crystals follow the Bayes law, so basically the specific heat that we can see here follow a cubic dependence with the temperature. But if we perform an experiment with amorphous silica, that is shown here, we see that this cubic dependence is not valid anymore. Instead, we find that the specific heat has a linear dependence at low temperature. And therefore, this anomalous behavior, so-called anomalous behavior, is not yet understood and completely. And therefore, in a sense, it exists a non-Debye contribution that somehow enters in this quantity. And we will go back to this at the very last moment of the presentation. So now let's move to the dynamical properties of glasses. On the left-hand side, we can see this famous plot regarding glasses and the glass formation. This is the log of the viscosity or log of the relaxation time as a function of the inverse of the temperature. So with decreasing the temperature, the viscosity of the glass increases dramatically. And so notice that this is the y-axis as this order of magnitude in a very narrow, a lot of magnitude, in a very narrow temperature window. Also, we can distinguish two classes of glasses, so-called fragile and strong glass former. Fragile glasses are this one that whose viscosity rapidly increase like this with this curvature, while instead a strong glass former such as silica, amorphous silica, present a straight Arrhenius behavior like this one.
And anyway, this is about the fluid phase, so the high temperature phase.
When you cool down the
liquid. Yeah, from the melt.
Yes, yes. Okay, so another interesting dynamical feature of glasses is the so-called dynamical heterogeneity. So regarding the relaxation mechanism of glasses, if you look at the real space picture, one can identify two different parts, one more mobile and another part of immobile region. And the numerical study of this group by Harwell and Reifman demonstrated that this kind of dynamical heterogeneity is tightly correlated with localized low-frequency vibrational modes. So the low-frequency vibrational modes are important to predict the dynamical behavior of glasses. Now let's move on briefly on the mechanical properties instead. So the mechanical properties are really important for industrial application, because ideally what we would like to do is to predict when and where glasses will break eventually. And so regarding this, I've selected the work of Manning and Liu in PRL 2011, where they propose that if you look again at these localized soft modes that are highlighted here, such regions tend to break first. And this means that if you look at the vibrational mode, low frequency vibrational mode, you can somehow predict where also the start the glass will break, will fail. And this has been also demonstrated by our group in a recent work in PRE 2019, where here we can see that the first bond breaking of silica glass. And we could predict the locus of this failure by looking at the smaller Eigen frequency. Okay, so now let's go to the vibrational properties that I wanted to explain. So from the physics textbook of solid state theory, we know that, for example, crystal, suppose we have a crystalline material, this is characterized by a periodic structure. So we know that for crystal, the famous Bayes' law holds for the density of state, the omega, which is proportional to omega to the d minus 1, where d is the spatial dimension. So assuming that we have a three-dimensional materials, atom or molecules form this kind of spring bonds, and therefore in this situation, we have the density of state follows omega squared. And another important highlight is that these phonon modes are extended, so are spatially extended modes. But now we want to know what about glasses or amorphous material that lack of the periodicity which is typical of crystals. So far, we don't have a clear scaling law for the density of state of glasses, and this indeed is the topic of our study. Actually, the recent numerical studies proposed that in amorphous materials, in addition to the phonon modes that are predicted by the Bayes theory, there are non-phonon modes that are typical of the glassy configurations, purely originated from amorphous configurations. And these can be described by this omega to the 4. So it means that the density of state for glasses is an hybridization of two contributions, phonon and non-phonon. Therefore, in order to observe this non-phonon contribution, we need to disentangle these modes, and therefore we need to find a way to distinguish these two. The recent paper by Lerner and Buchbinder, PRL 2016 and Turing, actually focused on this very important fact that the lowest phonon mode is actually determined by the size of the system size, in particular of the inverse of the system size. So it means that if you have a large system, the lowest phonon mode is at a very small frequency. On the other hand, if you have a small system size, the lowest phonon mode is quite higher. So it means that you can use this kind of protocol. One can use a smaller system to push the phonon modes toward the higher frequencies, and see whether the glassy non-phonon modes appears and are observable at a small frequency omega. And indeed, this is what they find, as we can see in this plot here on the left. So this is the density of state as a function of the omega. And we observe this omega fourth behavior for two different simple model of glasses. Furthermore, they observe that this kind of omega to the four mode is not extended as the phonon behavior, but actually is localized, as we can see here. And this is very different from, the standard Debye phonon-like modes. Okay, so this is the characteristic feature of glasses, non-phonon modes, scaling by omega to the 4. There are other ways to detect this non-phonon contribution. Another, for example, is reported in the PNAS of 2017 by the Ikeda group. They focus more on the participation ratio, which is a quantity that we will see in a while, rather than the system size. But however, so far, the non-phonon modes of the omega, proportional to omega to the 4, has been observed only in simple two-body potential systems that are useful for developing theoretical model of glasses, but also they describe fragile glass formers. Instead, nothing was done for more realistic glasses, multi-body potential system, describing realistic glasses, such as, for example, silica. And therefore, we want to ask, it is natural to ask, how about the realistic potential system that exceeds the spherical symmetry? Therefore, we focus on this topic, and we want to highlight also what is the behavior of a strong glass former as a silica. Okay. And this also is very important because ultimately we want to understand the general feature of glassy material, as I showed in the introduction. And we would like to develop, the last goal is to develop an understanding of glass in a generic and comprehensive way. So this is our first step. Here is our simulation method. We studied the realistic three-body potential model for silica proposed by Watanabe Group in Tokyo. And we perform molecular dynamics simulation using the LAMPS software. We start by putting randomly positioned atoms of silicon and oxygen in a cubic box. Then we perform some dynamics, Newtonian dynamics. Then we heat up the system up to 4000 Kelvin and then quench down again to 0 Kelvin. And then we produced a lot of configurations and we minimized them energetically using the fire scheme. So one important note regarding this minimization is that we require that each force, the force acting on each atom is less than 10 to the minus 10 ev over Armstrong. So we want to have our configuration. We want that our configuration are very well stable, very well minimized. After this, we calculate the Hessian matrix for these configurations and we diagonalize them to get the eigen values and the eigen frequencies and measure finally the omega. So now the central question was the choice of the system size, because we saw that the larger system, the modes are basically hybridized with the phonons, and everything is masked by the Debye-like behavior. So in order to remove this contribution, we follow the strategy by Lerner's group, and we studied the smaller system. And we ask whether we observed still the Debye or omega fourth in a realistic model of glass. So this is our first main result, which is the density of state for the lowest frequencies as a function of omega in the log-log scale for this different system size from 222 up to 4008 atoms. And as you can see, all system size follow this expected omega fourth behavior. And this, so we are happy because we observe this for the first time in a realistic silica potential. And so one note, as you see that when we go and look at the bigger system size, we start to see the phonon contribution that start to invade the low frequency regime. And then if we increase the system size, we start to see that this kind of, this omega fourth behavior is smeared out. Okay, so in order to get inside insight, we looked at spatial information about the omega fourth modes. Recall that the previous researcher work observed the omega four as a localized mode. And so here we to know information about the localization of the modes, we compute the participation ratio, which is basically for a single mode, how many particles participate in a given mode. So how many people is dancing in the room? If this PR is one, it means that all the particles participate in one mode. So for example, this is the translational motion of the entire system. On the other hand, if you have that this participation ratio is close to zero, it means that only few particles move in a given frequency. So this is the participation ratio as a function of the frequency for the three investigated system size. And here we can see a snapshot of the an example of very localized mode corresponding to the lowest, smallest value for the configuration system size of the bigger system size that is very localized. And this has a participation ratio of 0.001. Also, we can see that the signature of the extended phono modes that start to enter in this bigger system. And so we wanted to remove this mode, that therefore we focus on the smaller system size. So basically, these were our main results. So let me conclude. So as I said, the vibrational properties of glasses are very important to understand also other basic features of glasses, such as dynamical, thermodynamic, and mechanical properties, also as in the other solids. The recent work observed this non-phonon glassy localized mode with this trend, density of state proportional to omega to the four for some only for some simple model to body interaction. But for the first time, we found that this is true also for realistic silica glass model that has more than a simple to body interaction. And therefore, our study implies that this density of states that follows omega 4 is a generic property, or might be a generic property of amorphous materials. And this is an important step towards a complete understanding of glass and glass transition. And finally, as a future work, this is also related to another unsolved problem of the low temperature specific heat that I was mentioning before. In 1972, Anderson proposed that a possible cause of this anomalous behavior in the specific heat at low temperature might be due to the quantum two-level system, the existence of this two-level system, but their physical entity is not clarified yet. And so there is research ongoing that proposes that these localized glassy modes associated with this omega fourth behavior might be the candidates for this two-level system. So this is our future direction, and I thank you all for the attention.